The government's pushing for a gun register. It wants to get doctors to report concerns about owners to police and wants to toughen up the rules for gun clubs. But National's not on board. Police Minister Stuart Nash joins me now. Thank you very much for being here, Minister.
Yeah, pleasure, Jess.
This is a once-in-a-generation chance to reform our gun laws. Isn't it worth slowing down, taking the time, getting National on board?
Look, we have slowed down, we have taken the time, but let me say that most of these issues have been known since 1997 when Judge Thorpe wrote a report after our Moana suggesting a whole lot of changes. One thing I will say is that I offered to the National Party for the first time in my 2 years as a minister and the first time across any portfolios, my police officials to sit down with the National Party and work through any issues, and they did not take that up. That offer still exists.
But are you just playing politics with this as well? Why not actually sit down and say, right, this is bigger than all of us, let's get this done?
I don't want to play politics with this. I think 51 dead Kiwis is far too serious to play politics, and it is why I offered my officials to sit down with National, and this was done a couple of months ago.
But you're a minister. You can say to Brett Hudson, hey, come on, let's sort this out, let's get this done.
And in essence, we did. We said, hey, let's sort this out, let's get this done. We need to work together on this in a way that we worked together on that first tranche that saw these weapons that are primarily designed to kill people banned. We worked as a parliament. And it's disappointing that the Nats haven't come on board with this because I think this is too important to play politics.
But doesn't he have a point, though? Because aren't you targeting the law-abiding gun owners? And the gangs and the criminals can just carry on.
No, look, this is 1983 legislation. It has not been amended since then. We know the issues. This is about keeping our communities safe and ensuring that guns do not get into the hands of the wrong people.
So how? How are you going to do that? Because, I mean, the gun, if I'm a gang member, I'm not going to sign up to the nice little register and hand over my details and track where my guns are. I can just carry on like normal.
And if you're a gang member, you probably won't get a licence. And if you haven't got a licence, and we find you with a banned firearm, you're up for a massive fee, because what we have done is we've increased the penalties substantially. But, well, look, what we are doing is we've increased, for example, the fit and proper test, which determines who gets a licence and who doesn't get a licence. That has been significantly tightened, so the vast majority of law-abiding citizens that have gun licences will not be impacted upon this whatsoever, but it will stop those who are not fit to own a licence from getting their hands on guns.
Can you give me an idea of numbers? How many guns do you know about, and how many do you guess you don't know about?
Well, see, this is the great thing. We have absolutely no idea how many guns are out there because we do not have a register. What we do know is there's about 14,000 MSSAs. This is the military-style semi-automatic that we've now banned. But in terms of the AR-15, which is the sort of weapon the alleged terrorists used to kill 51 people, we have no idea whatsoever.
So in terms of looking at how many are out there, are you ever going to be able to know how many are on the black market?
Well, there's been a black market that's existed ever since firearms have existed.
Do you know roughly how many guns are in that black market?
No, we don't. But what we do want to do is get a better idea of where the guns are going. So what we do know is about 1,000 guns are stolen from good law-abiding Kiwis every single year, and they end up in the hands of the gangs. We want to prevent that. First of all, we want to know who's got the guns, what sort of guns they have got, and their conditions. At the moment, if the police recover guns, and they've recovered about 1,200 guns this year since the 1st of March, we have no idea where those guns have come from.
But all you're going to find out is from how many guns these law-abiding citizens have, and that's not going to stop something like the Christchurch attack, is it? Because he didn't fit into that category.
No, but it may well, actually. I mean, you know, there's a Royal Commission going on. I don't want to talk about a specific person, but the regime we are setting up at the moment, or proposing to set up, will stop people who are unfit to own firearms from getting them. We've tightened it up considerably.
Another point that I wanted to raise with you that Brett Hudson mentioned was around these doctor's visits. So if a member of the community goes to their GP and has a firearms licence and the GP raises concerns about their mental health, don't you get nervous that it's just going to shut down people talking about mental health, particularly in smaller rural communities?
No, look, not at all. What we've put in the legislation is the GP should consider notifying the police if the GP has concerns about the person who has a gun licence. It doesn't mean they have to, it means they consider notifying. If the GP actually believes there's a better way to deal with the situation, then they can suggest that course of action. Under the Privacy Act 1993, GPs can in fact go to police now and say we believe there is a serious threat. So that isn't changing anything. But, you know, keeping in mind that the way the license regime is going to be set up is it's self-policing. So we expect people who are not fit and proper or who have fallen below that test to self-notify.
But that's not going to work with people who are intent on breaking the law, is it?
No, but going to a medical professional is the fallback position on this. So what we're saying is, just because you're suffering from a mental illness does not mean you will not get a firearms license, or does not mean we'll take your license off you. What it may mean is that we'll work with you to ensure that you have all the all the processes in place to make sure you are fit and proper. Keeping in mind, you know, I just want to go back to those high-level principles. This is about ensuring that guns do not get into the wrong hands, and this is the whole regime, what the whole regime's about.
I want to ask you a different question now. Over the weekend, the job for the new police commissioner, there was an advert in the Dominion Post. Mm. Do you hope that the new police commissioner will change the culture of police, and how much does that need to happen?
Look, I think Mike Bush has done a fantastic job, considering when he took over police, it was about 3 years after the first Baisley report, which basically said police culture is rotten and needs to change. Over the years that he has been in the police, I think he has changed the culture significantly and has done a fantastic job.
So if it was rotten then, what is it now?
I think the culture is fantastic, I really do.
Because that's not what the reports around at the moment are saying, is that there are real issues.
No, what it's saying is that some people have come forward and said they have been bullied. And I know the Commissioner takes this very seriously, I take this very seriously, and I have expressed my concerns to the Commissioner around this, that anyone who feels they have been bullied needs to be able to report this in a safe manner. But, you know, I don't know the specific details around each allegation, and I do expect police to deal with them in an appropriate manner. But I think, by and large, the culture within police has come, you know, it's chalk and cheese compared to what it was when Margaret Baisley wrote that first report.
Really interesting stuff that we'll keep an eye out. But thank you very much for your time this evening, Minister.